Motivation is an internal process that makes a person move achieve a goal. Individual's behavior can be identified by the motivations. We can see mainly there are two types of motivations. They are homeostatic motivation and non-homeostatic motivation. In that part, we are going to explain what the non-homeostatic motivation is. The non-homeostatic system has less to do with the internal biology and everything to do with the external environment. Essentially, the non-homeostatic system deals with the issues related to food intake that are not governed by the homeostatic system. There are many examples to describe about the non-homeostatic motivation, and the examples such as the hiking and climbing mountains, and good sexual behavior is also a good example for the non-homeostatic motivation. When we talk about the non-homeostatic motivation, there are some theories that we can take for the good explanation about the non-homeostatic motivation. The first one is the arousal theory and the incentive theory and the Maslow's hierarchy of self-actualization theories we can take for the description of the non-homeostatic motivation.
Hi everyone, this is Dananji here. I just thought of talking to you all about something that I really love to share with. It's all about passion, it's all about the things that I love to do and the effects of motivation which would lead me to have the interest on the same thing that I would love to do. So I call the passion of my life is basically it's all about music. I love music, I love singing, I love playing as well. So there are things which motivates me or which keeps me going, keeps me up and keeps me interested in doing the same. And basically when it comes to my friends, they really love to hear me singing. Whenever I'm somewhere, they just come and they just wanted me to come and sing with them. And they just support me with some kind of a drum, with some kind of a thing. They help me, they support me, and they enjoy the singing that I do. And when it comes to their comments, that is the most beautiful part as well, because they just comment on the things, they just comment on the songs that I do, that I sing for them. Those comments can be the positive ones and negative ones as well. And I would love the both of them, because it's true that they love the singing, and it's true when they just come and tell me if this doesn't suit you, if the song doesn't suit your voice color, maybe the way you sing and all, they just tell me. And those comments really keeps me going. It really encourages me. And also when I see somebody else also singing, maybe some screen thing, maybe a movie thing, it motivates me to try the same thing out, try the same song, and just have some fun on that. And also, I would also love to say my parents. They really love to keep me singing. They love to hear me singing. So, because that encouraged me as well. Because for a person, everybody today is very busy in their lives. So they keep on having a very busy life. So I think there should be some kind of a passion, some kind of a thing that you love to do. And also there should be some motivation effect as well to keep on developing the same. So when it comes to my life, I believe that singing is all about my passion in life, and also my friends, people around me, good and bad things, everything, the things that I see, the things that I love to do are the motivation effects. So this is what I wanted to just talk to you all regarding. And I would also love if you just try in yourselves about the things that you love to do, and just see what are the things that encourages you to do this, and keep on developing them. It really brings you some kind of a pleasure in your life. Thank you.
It's clear that the different people prefer different levels of excitement, and we all know people have different types of sensations. People who like a lot of activity find sufficient stimulation in reading, going for work, and engage in casual conversations, and people who like a high level of activity find sufficient stimulation in climbing mountains, hiking, and drive race cars or run marathons, etc. It seems that such high levels of activity actually relax these individuals' minds. And also, in order for such differences in motivation and behavior, psychologists have proposed arousal theories. According to these models, we try to maintain an optimal level of arousal. As example, a woman who has a low optimal level of arousal may escape for a quiet weekend retreat when she is overloaded at work. And also, a man who needs a higher level of stimulation may spend leisure time by riding a motorcycle or listening to loud music. Simple tasks can accommodate much higher levels of arousal before performance begins to fail off, and more difficult tasks require much lower level of arousal for optimal performance. Arousal theory makes it clear that the level of excitement that is best for one person is one situation may be suitable for other persons or other circumstances.
Of the Department of Economics and Statistics, I'm following a statistics special degree program in currently, and it's, I guess this is a blessing for me to explain and express about the inspiration I got from the external parties to admire my life like this. So if I talk about my inspirations that I had got from the external parties, I partly work as a junior lecturer at IAS Institute, and I'm conducting lectures for ICASL students as well as for the AAT students. And if I talk about how I have become a person like this, when I was doing my AAT examinations, that was the first exam I was doing in English medium, and I was got scared. Then one of my lectures in the IAS, they inspired me to do that examinations in English medium. So that was the first step that I have done, I have taken to my life to inspire myself. And once I was passing the staff room, I was looking on them and I saw the way they were behaving at the staff room, that people were kind of imaginary people that I haven't ever experienced that that environment. So I thought to myself, I talked to my conscious, and I decided one day I will become a lecturer in the same institute as they are. So then my lecturers, I want to tell that people were amazing. They helped me a lot to become as a junior lecturer, and that people advised me how to walk in this path, and that people still staying behind me, and they will always help me to do the best thing for my students as well as for my life. So that is what I see as external parties, and I guess according to this topic, I have given inspirational speech as well. So I guess one day everyone can become the person that they are imagined to become as well as they are dreamed to become, with the help of the other people, with the help of the situations around you, as well as the help of the environment behind you. And I'm actually happy about myself, and I have become a junior lecturer, and I will be a senior lecturer one day in my university as well. That is my only hope.
Incentive theory maintains a contrasting viewpoint. In here, certain behaviors offer intrinsic rewards, which means that they are interesting and fun to do even when they produce no external benefits. By contrast, extrinsic rewards such as money, food, and public recognition produce stratification independently of the behaviors that produce them. Whereas experientially motivated behavior appears to be regulated by response. Produce external events. Intrinsically motivated behavior comes from within and the rewards are internal. Incentive theory argues that we are sufficiently motivated by goal attainment. It is unnecessary to propose that behavior is geared toward anything other than obtaining a specific reward.
A hierarchy of needs, beginning with basic bodily and safety demands and progressing to needs for fulfillment, determines which behaviors occur. On occasion, a person may choose to satisfy needs higher in the hierarchy. As examples, we can take love, affection, and the caring for others. While disregarding needs lower in the hierarchy, we can take as safety, security, and protection. Here, it shows five interrelated levels. In order for needs higher on the scale to become relevant motivational concerns, needs contained in the lower levels must be satisfied. The most primitive and the most basic needs are psychological. Before we look to anything else, we must attend to breathing, eating, drinking, and procreation. Given that these demands are satisfied, we then enter the levels of safety needs and go about securing a safe, orderly, and supportive environment. Our behavior adjusts to the prevailing deprivation conditions and satisfies the most pressing needs.